How long would it take us to get to Titan? Titan is the only body in the solar system, other than Earth, where liquid bodies have been found, and the only moon known to have a dense atmosphere. Today, Titan is the most promising place in the solar system, where scientists believe there could be microbial living beings because it has conditions similar to those on Earth millions of years ago. But although Titan is the most exciting place to search for life in the entire solar system, the last spacecraft that visited this distant world took more than 7 years to get there. How long would it take modern spacecraft? How long would a human-crewed spacecraft take? Keep watching to find out. Titan is the second largest moon in the solar system after Ganymede, and is larger than the planet Mercury, although its mass is only 40% that of Mercury. This difference in mass is because even though Mercury is smaller, most of Mercury is iron, while most of Titan is ice. This satellite was discovered on March 25, 1655, by the astronomer Christian Huygens. Since its discovery, it has never been a striking place for scientists, as observations from Earth have not provided us with much information about it. It wasn't until the 20th century that astronomical observations began to reveal interesting facts about Titan. In 1907, Spanish astronomer Joseph Comas y Sola used the telescope at the Fabra Observatory in Catalonia, Spain, to study the Titan satellite and discover that on the surface of the satellite, there were dark spots that faded and reappeared after a long time. The only way to explain those mysterious dark spots is that Titan had a dense atmosphere like Earth's. But with the telescopes of the time, it was impossible to determine it. The idea that Titan could have an atmosphere remained in doubt until 1944, when the astronomer Gerard Kuiper managed to observe the satellite with a much more powerful telescope and use the spectroscopy technique to see Titan at different wave frequencies. Spectroscopy is a technique used by astronomers in which visible light from an object is passed through a prism or refracting lens. This splits the light coming from an object into all its frequencies separately, including infrared light and ultraviolet light, which are not perceptible to the human eye. Using this technique, it is possible to determine the composition of different objects, and it was thus that Kuiper discovered that Titan did indeed have a dense atmosphere and that it was composed of methane. This discovery motivated scientists to study this distant world more deeply, and it is for that reason that in the 1970s, when space exploration missions of the solar system began, one of the most exciting objects to study was Titan. Missions. Before the 1970s, all we knew about Titan was what we could observe through telescopes on Earth. It was known to be a sizable artificial satellite. Even many scientists calculated that maybe it was the biggest in the entire solar system because it reflects a lot of sunlight. But later, with other planetary exploration missions, the Pioneer 10 probe would reveal that Ganymede, Jupiter's largest moon, was slightly larger than Titan. The first mission to explore this world was NASA's Pioneer 11 probe. This mission was part of the Pioneer program, which aimed to study the interstellar medium and the solar system's outer planets. The Pioneer 11 probe was launched on April 6, 1973, aboard an Atlas Centaur launch vehicle from Space Launch Complex 36A at Cape Canaveral in Florida. 6 years after its launch, on September 1, 1979, the Pioneer 11 probe would finally reach Saturn, becoming the first artifact created by humanity to pass close to the planet. A minefield. Before the Pioneer 11 probe, it was known that orbiting Saturn would be challenging for any spacecraft, since Saturn has a ring of asteroids. Therefore, any spacecraft that passes close to it must do so very carefully, otherwise it could collide with an object. That's precisely what happened to it in 1979. A day before Pioneer 11 arrived at Saturn, NASA scientists used the spacecraft's cameras to take a picture of the planet to determine the best route to avoid any collision with an unexpected object. Remarkably, the images captured by Pioneer 11 captured something scientists hadn't expected, a moon they'd never seen. That moon was Epimetheus. But how could astronomers have never seen this moon before? The reason is that Epimetheus is in the same orbit as the moon Janus, that is, both moons share the same orbit around Saturn. Before Epimetheus' discovery, astronomers believed there was only one body in that orbit, and they did not think the two moons could share the same orbit without eventually colliding. but that's just what they discovered. Epimetheus and Janus are two unique moons in the solar system sharing the same orbit without colliding. These moons look like two pendulums that move closer and farther away from each other, exchanging their orbits every 4 years in a back-and-forth dance in which they move closer and farther apart, but never collide. This orbital behavior is unique in the solar system and has never been observed before. So when astronomers discovered this moon a day before Pioneer 11 arrived at Saturn, it was tough to predict where the moon would be the next day. Many orbital calculations were made to prevent Pioneer 11 from colliding with Epimetheus. At the last minute, NASA scientists managed to readjust the direction of the spacecraft, which managed to evade this new moon by passing very close to it at a distance of no more than 2,500 miles or 4,000 kilometers. Thanks to the quick action of NASA scientists and engineers, the Pioneer 11 probe managed to pass by Saturn and take photos of Titan. But this event was a reminder that Saturn is an unpredictable planet, where an asteroid or moon can suddenly appear that could put a space mission heading to Titan at risk. This first approach of Pioneer 11 to Saturn managed to obtain the first images of Titan, which show that it was a world with an atmosphere so dense that we were not allowed to see below it. The infrared camera showed a place so cold that it was impossible for any form of life to survive there. Years later, the Voyager 1 and 2 probes also managed to pass close to Titan and showed us more detailed images where we could see that Titan was a moon like no other. In the images captured by the Voyager probes, Titan was found to be covered by a dense atmospheric haze that prevented direct images of the surface. But in 2004, intensive digital processing of images taken through Voyager 1's orange filter revealed two huge regions on Titan's surface, a substantial dark region now known as Shangri-La, and another bright region now known as Xanadu. Shangri-La is currently considered an immense sea of dark, carbon-rich sand, and one of Titan's three major equatorial sand seas. This region is teeming with glowing islands of higher ground called inselbergs, which are thought to be protrusions of icy bedrock, although the exact composition is currently unknown. On the other hand, Xanadu is a region similar to a highly reflective water ice plateau the size of Australia, which contrasts somewhat with the darker lower regions. Suppose the Xanadu region is confirmed to be composed of water ice. In that case, Titan will become one of the solar system's bodies with the most water reserves, surpassing Earth. Before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can approve them for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. The first landing on Titan. One of the reasons it has been challenging to get to Titan is because everything we know about this natural satellite is very recent. Unlike Mars, which is the second closest planet to Earth and is visible with amateur telescopes, astronomers have been able to study it for centuries. Our information about Titan is not even a half century old. For that reason, not as many space exploration missions have yet been sent to the satellite as to Mars. The first space mission to land on Titan was the Cassini-Huygens space probe. This spacecraft was launched in 1997 and was equipped with the most modern systems. It has also been one of the heaviest uncrewed spacecrafts, totaling 12,593 pounds or 5,712 kilograms. For reference, the Pioneer 11 probe weighed just 568.7 pounds or 258 kilograms, or 22 times less than the Cassini-Huygens space probe. As we have mentioned in other videos, the weight of a spacecraft defines how long it will take to reach its destination. The more it weighs, the more fuel it needs, and the more fuel it needs, the more its weight increases, and therefore the longer it takes to reach its destination. A human-crewed ship designed to travel the enormous distance between Earth and Titan would have to be 40 times larger than the ships that went to the moon, and therefore would weigh 40 times more, need 40 times more the fuel. And even then, there is no guarantee that it could reach Saturn in less than 15 years. Fortunately, this time can be shortened using gravitational assists. This is a method scientists use to accelerate spacecraft using the gravitational pull of solar system bodies. A planet's gravity is always much more substantial than that of other objects, such as moons or asteroids. So engineers always try to get spacecraft to take advantage of the alignment of planets to reduce travel time. However, the problem with this method is that the planets are not always aligned, so their gravity cannot always be used to accelerate spacecraft. For an alignment between the planets to occur, they took advantage of the fact that the asteroid 2685 Mussorgsky would pass close to Earth to propel the spacecraft to Jupiter and thus reach Saturn in less time, as shown in the animation of the spacecraft's trajectory. The Cassini-Huygens space probe reached Saturn in just 7 years thanks to this gravity assist maneuver. If the gravity of asteroid 2685 Mussorgsky had not been exploited, the travel time would have been at least double. Cassini-Huygens was a dual-purpose spacecraft divided into two sections, the first being Cassini. This orbiter would be responsible for orbiting Saturn, capturing images and data of the gaseous planet and Saturn's ring system and moons, while Huygens consisted of a landing probe that aimed to enter Titan's atmosphere to observe beneath its dense cloud cover. The Huygens probe was docked to Cassini. On December 25, 2004, Huygens separated from Cassini and landed on Titan on January 14, 2004, near a region known as Adiri. Huygens' landing is, so far, the only one made in the outer solar system, and it was also the first on a moon other than Earth. The Huygens probe managed to take the only images of Titan's surface so far. It also collected a wealth of information about Titan, from its composition, atmosphere, temperature, lighting, air gases, water traces, and life. Thanks to this, we now know that Titan is a world very similar to Earth, with a methane cycle analogous to the water cycle on Earth. It is the only body beside Earth where bodies in a liquid state have been found, and the most promising place so far where it is known that there could be living beings. We must remember that all this information about Titan was discovered thanks to the Cassini-Huygens space probe, which ended its mission only on September 15, 2017. That is, less than 10 years ago, at the time of recording this video. In other words, if not so many space exploration missions have been sent to Titan, and human crewed missions are not being planned in the coming years, it is because since all these discoveries were made, and up to the present date, very little time has passed. The data sent back by space probes is still being studied by scientists and astronomers worldwide. New things about this moon are being discovered every day. It should also be remembered that going to Saturn is challenging. The heavier a spacecraft is, the longer it will take to arrive. Addition the fact that once on Saturn, the spacecraft must perform several evasion maneuvers to avoid colliding with any of the objects in Saturn's ring or with any of the 95 moons. That is why, if today we were to send a human-crewed spacecraft to Saturn's largest moon, it would take more than a decade to reach Titan if it ever arrives. To this, we must add the time that the astronauts would be on Titan, and then the time it would take them to return to Earth, adding up to more than 20 years of travel. For now, that is a journey that the human race cannot make. In short, going to Titan is tough. It takes a very long time. And there's no guarantee that we can send humans to this world, at least in this century. However, NASA is currently planning a new uncrewed mission called Dragonfly that will study this natural Saturn satellite, further using a drone that will fly through the skies of Titan in search of life forms. Would you like us to make a video about NASA's Dragonfly mission? Let us know what you think in the comments.